Shall we start?
Yes, sir.
Who is the presenter?
Sir, I will be presenting, sir. Aneshwara.
Okay, start.
Yes, sir, I'll be presenting my screen. Patient is Mr. Mohan, a 50-year-old male, who's a school teacher by occupation from Madura Oil. He's right-handed and he's been brought in by his wife, who's a reliable informant. He came in with chief complaints of difficulty in using the right upper and lower limbs since 3 days and inability to speak since 3 days. So patient was apparently normal 3 days back and he was able to perform his daily routine activities. Then he went to sleep at 3 p.m. Following this, when patient attempted to get up from his bed at 6 p.m., his knees buckled and he fell, but there was no accompanying loss of consciousness, sir. Following the fall, the patient noticed difficulty in using the right arm and right leg with deviation of mouth to the left, sir. And 30 minutes later, patient noticed the inability to speak. Patient was taken to a nearby private hospital from where he was referred to RGGH. Then, his history of presenting illness is as follows. When a patient is able to lift his arm over his head, he's able to reach for objects over his head. And patient is able to comb his hair, but he has difficulty in holding a glass and he has difficulty buttoning his shirt, mixing food and in writing. And patient has difficulty in standing up from sitting posture and he has buckling of knees. And patient needs support to walk and he finds it difficult to wear his right slipper. Yes, sir.
Can you go back to the chief complaints?
Yes, sir.
Can you put a slide?
Sorry, come on, please. Yes, sir.
Can you put the slideshow? Slideshow.
Oh, okay, okay, okay. Yes, sir. Put the slideshow.
Okay. So, right upper and lower limb since 3 days.
Yes, sir.
Okay. What is the right hand handedness?
Handedness would mean which hand is, it would mean which side, which hand would be used more dominantly, sir, by the person.
For your patient, which side?
The patient is right-handed, sir.
For your patient, it's right-handed.
Yes, sir. Sir?
Can you hear, ma?
Yes, sir. Now I can't hear, sir.
Yeah, continue. You can continue.
Oh, okay, sir. So, then patient is able to lift his head off the pillow and has no problem turning from side to side. The patient feels his right lower limb to be loose and he has dragging of legs, but he has no loss, any loss of bulk. Patient is able to take food to the mouth and does not have any associated involuntary movements. Patient is unable to speak. However, he is able to understand the words spoken by his wife and can identify objects.
Okay.
And yes, sir.
Continue.
The patient is able to perceive smell. He is able to see objects and he can even appreciate color. And he does not give any history of double vision or any eyelid drooping, sir. patient has no difficulty in chewing his food. He is able to close his eyes fully and he does not complain of any dryness of eyes. He has a deviation of his mouth is deviated to the left, sir, and there is drooling of saliva present. Patient is not hard of hearing and he does not have any tinnitus or vertigo. And patient has no history of nasal regurgitation of food, no history of difficulty in shrugging shoulders and turning head from side to side. And patient has no difficulty using his tongue for swallowing. Patient is able to appreciate sensation of cloth, floor, cot, warmth and cold pain. And he does not, when asked, he did not report falling forwards while washing his face. I mean to say that a wash patient sign is negative, sir. And patient had no giddiness, palpitations, excessive sweating. No, he does not report any bowel and bladder incontinence. Patient has no history of breathlessness, chest pain, ankle edema. He has no history of abdominal pain, distension, or jaundice. He does not have any associated fever, projectile vomiting, or headache. And he does not give any history of trauma to the head or the spinal cord. And patient does not have any history of loss of weight or appetite. That's a history of presenting illness.
Okay. Can you summarize your positive history alone?
Only the positive history alone. Patient has yes, proximal, I mean distal muscle weakness in right upper limb, sir. And
only distal or proximal is also involved.
According to him, sir, he's able to lift his arm, and proximal is relatively better, sir.
Okay. What about the lower limb?
Lower limb both seem to be affected, sir.
Proximal as well as distal muscles are affected on the right side.
Yes, sir, right side.
Okay.
And patient also has. Patient also is unable to speak, but he is able to understand. Okay. And he has deviation of mouth.
Deviation of?
Angle of mouth to the left.
To the left. So yes. Any other cranial nerve is involved according to your history?
No, sir. No other cranial nerve is involved.
Okay. So with your history alone, what can you say about the findings? What is your provisional diagnosis?
Sir, there was no. It seems to be right-sided hemiparesis, sir. And
paresis or plegia?
Paresis, sir, because he's only having difficulties. It's not inability, sir.
Okay, what is the difference between hemiplegia and hemiparesis?
A plegia would be complete paralysis, sir, and paresis would be weakness.
So what will be the power difference in hemiplegia and hemiparesis? When you say the patient is hemiplegia, what should be the power?
Less than 3, sir.
Power should be 0.
0.
Okay. Hemiplegia, if you say, the power is 0. Okay.
0.
If you say hemiparesis, it should be 1+. Okay.
Okay.
So now your differential or provisional diagnosis will be?
A right-sided hemiparesis associated with UMN and aphasia.
UMN or LMN only after your examination finding you can comment. Okay.
Okay.
Now you can say that the 7th cranial nerve is also involved.
With involved, okay. Yes.
Okay. Now we go back to past history.
Past history of the patient. The patient does not have any history of similar complaints in the past or of any transient ischemic attack or reversible ischemic neurological deficit, sir. Any history
of that reversible ischemic neurological deficit? What is it called?
RIMD.
Any terminology used? What is PRESS, PRESS syndrome? Posterior reversible encephalitis syndrome. Okay. It is a type of reversible ischemic neurological deficit. Press. Okay.
Press.
Define transient ischemic attack. TIA.
So, transient ischemic attack is a focal neurological deficit that resolves, that has an acute onset and resolves within 24 hours without leaving any permanent lasting neurological deficit.
Okay, so is it a reversible or irreversible?
It's reversible, sir.
Reversible. Okay. What are the names and causes of TIA?
So, carotid artery occlusion. Not occlusion, okay. Sir. Carotid artery atherosclerosis, embolization.
Okay. Causes. You are seeing the pathology.
Yes. So atherosclerosis in itself, valvular heart diseases leading to atrial fibrillation.
Yeah, it could be a valvular heart disease. Okay. It could be a valvular heart disease. It could be a. Then what else?
So, hypertension induced vasospasms.
Okay, what is amaurosis pugax?
Amaurosis pugax is monocular blindness, sir. It's a type of transient ischemic attack. It resolves within 24 hours. So
where there will be the blood clots? In your?
Central retinal arteries.
Central retinal artery. Okay.
Yes, sir.
So, all these are transient ischemic attacks. Now, what are the risk factors in your patient?
The patient has, patient is a known case of type 2 diabetes mellitus, sir. And for 10 years, he's been on regular medications and he even has systemic hypertension and dyslipidemia, sir, for 5 years, and he's on regular oral medication. Other than that, there's no significant history, sir. No history of valvular heart disease, epilepsy, tuberculosis, and no history of dog bite.
Why did you ask the history of dog bite?
Sir, rabies, it could lead to flaccid paralysis.
Is it an ascending type or a descending type of paralysis? Rabies.
Ascending type, sir.
What about polio?
Polio is descending, sir. Polio.
Sorry?
Polio is descending type of family.
Okay. What about snake bite? Snake bite.
Ascending type, sir.
Snake bite is a descending type. Starts with your cranial nerve and it comes down to the diaphragm.
Okay.
So, all these things should be asked in the past history. Okay, continue.
Then personal history of the patient, sir. He's a mixed diet consumer and he has a normal sleep pattern with normal bowel and bladder functions. And he has no he denies any history of alcohol consumption, sir. But he has a history of smoking present. He smoked. He smoked 2 packs of cigarette per day for 15 years, sir, and he stopped 3 years ago. So that comes to 30 pack years, sir. And patient denies any other high-risk behaviors like IV drug abuse and extramarital affairs.
Okay. The dates of I asked, what is pack year and smoke index? No?
Yes, sir.
So what is pack year?
Pack years would be number of cigarettes consumed per day divided by 20 into the number of years for which patient is smoking.
So what is the significance of this pack years?
So it gives an estimate of how much smoke exposure the patient has, sir, and we could decide.
So what is the risk factor of the smoke pack years? What does it say? What are the risk factors of smoking?
Smoking could lead to it's a risk factor for atherosclerosis, sir, and it's also a risk factor for many lung diseases, obstructive lung diseases, even carcinoma of lung. And smoking is also this risk factor for strokes.
What is smoke index? You didn't refer. What is smoke index?
I couldn't find it in Hutchins.
My clerk will be giving it. Find it out.
Yes, sir.
Okay, next class you have to say. Maybe upcoming class. Okay, now so he is having a risk factor of smoking, right?
Yes, sir.
Okay, proceed. And other risk factors are diabetic and hypertension.
Yes.
Okay, continue.
Family history, none of the family members have suffered from similar complaints of paralysis, but patient's father had type 2 diabetes mellitus for 15 years. He's on insulin and oral hypoglycemic agents. Other than that, no family history of hypertension, migraine, coronary artery disease, epilepsy. Sir.
Okay.
And drug history, sir, for his diabetes, patient is on tablet metformin and glimepiride, sir. And for hypertension, patient is on tablet amlodipin, sir, 5 milligrams. For his dyslipidemia, he's on atorvastatin, sir.
Okay. Name some side effects of atorvastatin.
Sir, myopathy.
Yes.
Myopathy. Then? What typical complaints the patient say when you ask the patient muscle pain? Okay,
muscle.
Very good. Why is it given in night alone? You have written atorvastatin once daily, no?
Yes, sir. Yeah, yes.
What time it will be given?
Yes, sir. Just before bed. So, because cholesterol synthesis is maximum at night.
Is that the reason? When will be the HMG-CoA enzyme more?
At night time, sir.
During the night time.
Okay.
Fine. Continue.
Yes, sir. Then the summary of the case, sir, from history. So we have Mr. Mohan, a 50-year-old right-handed male, an ex-smoker, and a known case of diabetes mellitus, hypertension, and dyslipidemia. He presented a difficulty in using right upper and lower limbs with deviation of angle of mouth to the left and inability to speak since 3 days with no family history of stroke. It is probably an acute ischemic stroke of thrombotic etiology involving maybe less, possibly left middle cerebral artery, sir.
How did he say the left middle cerebral artery is involved here?
Sir, because of the dense involvement is there, sir. Both the upper and lower limbs. And and the sparing of bowel and bladder, so that does not point to anterior cerebral artery involvement, sir.
Okay, fine.
And so the general examination, sir. Patient is conscious, alert, oriented to time, place, and person. He is comfortable at rest and he obeys commands. Patient is moderately built and nourished and he has a BMI of 23.2 kg per meter square. And patient has no pallor, icterus, cyanosis, clubbing, pedal edema, significant generalized lymphadenopathy, sir. And patient has no neurocutaneous markers. he has no markers of atherosclerosis, sir, and he also does not have markers of TB, HIV, or neurosyphilis. The vitals, sir, the pulse rate of the patient was 78 beats per minute and it had regular rhythm with normal volume and character. Vessel wall thickening was felt, but there's no radioradial or radiofemoral delay, and pulses were felt in all peripheral pulses were felt.
Okay.
Blood pressure was measured in the left arm with the patient sitting upright, sir. It was 148 upon 82 millimeters of mercury. The respiratory rate was 20 breaths per minute. He has regular breathing and it's abdominal thoracic type, sir, without using any accessory respiratory muscle use. And temperature of patient 98.5 Fahrenheit. He's afebrile, sir.
Okay.
Then there's central nervous system examination, sir. The higher mental functions were tested, sir. The patient is conscious, alert, cooperative, oriented to time, place, and person. He's determined to be right-handed, and his immediate, recent, and remote memory seems to be intact. And patient's spontaneous speech is absent, but his reading comprehension and writing are preserved, and his calculation skills appear to be normal. And cranial nerves next. So,
okay.
Cranial nerves were tested as follows. The first cranial nerve, first cranial nerve patient was able to detect the smell. Second cranial nerve, also visual acuity was found to be 612 in both eyes. In both eyes, visual field was normal and color vision was present, sir. And pupil was found in both eyes, 4 millimeters in size and round. And reflexes were tested, sir, involving the second and third cranial. All the reflexes and accommodation reflexes were present, and ptosis was not seen. And the third, fourth, and sixth cranial nerves were tested the ocular extraocular movements, sir, which were full. And for the fifth cranial nerve, all motor functions were present, and there was no temporal fossa wasting. And ophthalmic, maxillary, and mandibular inner areas had sensation present, sir. And jaw jerk reflexes present, with corneal and conjunctival reflexes are also present.
Okay.
And cranial nerves, sir, under the motor component of the seventh cranial nerves, wrinkling of forehead and closing of eyes were present, and nasolabial folds were present. But on baring his teeth, sir, it was noticed that the angle of his mouth deviated to the left, sir.
Okay.
And blowing of cheeks would be absent, sir. And platysma contraction is absent on the left side, sir.
Okay.
So, and sensation was not affected, sir. It was present on both sides. And lacrimation was present, sir, again in both sides. It was tested using Schirmer's test, and corneal conjunctival reflexes were of course present, sir. And eighth nerve was also determined to be normal, and all the other nerves were normal, sir. 9, 10, 11, and 12.
Okay.
So far, in the only abnormality was in the seventh facial nerve, sir, where in the motor area, sir.
So now you tell me whether it is a UMN type of facial palsy or an LMN type. How are you going to differentiate?
It appears to be an UMN type of facial palsy, sir, because there's
UMN type.
there seems to be a sparing of the upper half of the face. And there's a deviation of mouth and blowing his cheeks is absent. Yes, sir. And it's right platysma, sir, contraction that is absent, not the left, sir. And okay. So because of that, yes, it appears to be a UMN lesion, sir, so far.
What is the nerve supply of your orbicularis oculi?
Orbicularis oculi. So I think oculi. Upper half is the temporal branch of the facial nerve, sir. Lower half is the zygomatic branch of facial nerve.
Facial nerve.
Ptosis? Ptosis. It's the paralysis of levator palpebrae superioris, sir, which is innervated by the third cranial nerve.
Okay. What is Muller muscle?
Muller's muscle is the part of levator palpebrae superioris which has a sympathetic innervation, sir.
Okay. Fine, proceed.
Yes. Then motor system testing, the bulk on inspection, right upper and lower limbs do not appear to have any wasting, fasciculations or involuntary muscle movements. And upper limb bulk was measured 10 centimeter above olecranon process. On the right upper limb, it was 20 centimeters, sir, the circumference, and left it was 19 centimeters, sir. And below the olecranon process, it was 19 centimeter on the
19. Do you see any decrease in the bulk in case of human type of palsy?
Not immediately, sir. After a few weeks, possibly.
What was the reason for decrease in the bulk?
Sir, due to disuse atrophy, sir. And.
Okay. In case of element type?
Element type is atrophy is present, sir.
Why there is atrophy immediately? In case of element type, and why in human type it's going to take a longer time?
So in UMN type, it's the nerves above the anterior horn cells that are affected. So the anterior horn cells are still, the spinal nerves are still intact, sir. So that's why in UMN it takes longer time.
Okay. Fine. Proceed.
Yes, sir. And in the lower limbs, sir, 10, this 18 centimeters, sir. 18 centimeter above the upper border of patella, it's 31 centimeters on the right side, sir, and 31 centimeters on the left side. And 10 centimeter below tibial tuberosity, it's 22 centimeters on the right side and 21 centimeters on the left side, sir. Then the tone was tested.
Is there an obvious decrease in the bulk?
There's no obvious decrease, sir.
Okay, then proceed.
Yes. Then tone, sir, the upper limb and lower limb was tested, sir, and it was found to be hypotonia in both the right upper limb and right lower limb, sir.
Okay.
Then power was tested, sir, over each joint. In the shoulder, all the movements
had. What is the classification name used for power?
Sir, the Medical Research Council classification, sir, MRC.
How many grades are there?
This 5 grades, sir.
5 or 6?
6. 0 is absolutely no movement at all, sir.
Yeah. 0 is also included. So, 0, yes. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So, total 6 grades are there.
6 grades are there, sir.
Okay.
Yes.
And in 4 also, you have 4 minus and 4 plus. 4 minus means very little resistance. 4 minus, 4 plus is maximum resistance.
Okay. Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
Right.
And over the shoulder, the movements were all tested. Each movement had a power of 3. In the elbow, the movements had on the right side had a power of 2, sir. And wrist on the right side had flexion, extension, and abduction, adduction movements had a power of 2, while pronation, supination had a power of 3, sir. Fingers.
So all the power.
3 or. Yes, sir. There's decreased power. Okay. Yes.
Okay, proceed.
And in the lower limbs, sir, the hip movements, the power was 4, while the knee and ankle movements, the power was 3, while in the toes, it was 2, sir.
Okay, proceed.
And reflexes were tested, sir. So on the left side, all the reflexes were present and normal, and plantar reflex was flexor. On the right side, however, abdominal and cremastic reflexes were diminished, sir. Plantar reflex was also diminished.
Plantar, you cannot say it is diminished.
Yes.
Neither say it is a mute reflex, or mute. Is it a flexor reflex, or it is an extensor reflex?
Yes, a mute reflex.
So what is the root value of plantar reflex?
L4, L5, S1, sir.
Okay. What is extensor plantar?
Extensor plantar is the Babinski reflex, sir. And stroking
What is Babinski's test?
When we stroke with a blunt object, the patient's sole on the lateral side of the sole, sir. From the heel, we stroke to the 5th toe, sir, and then towards the base of the 1st toe. Then we see this dorsiflexion of the great toe and fanning out of all the other toes, and this flexion of the knee and hip, withdrawal of the limb.
Okay. What are all the other equivalents of plantar reflex or Babinski's reflex?
This supinator, in the upper limb, this.
Other equivalents of Babinski's. Many reflex are there, no? Gordon's reflex, Wings reflex, Oppenheimer test. You're aware or not?
Yes, sir. I thought they were maneuvers when we didn't get any extensor plantar.
Other Babinski's equivalents.
Equivalents. Okay. Yeah.
Babinski equivalents in upper limb. What test you have?
I don't know.
Babinski's or plantar, you will see Babinski's in lower limb. What is it? Yes. Equivalent in upper limb?
Hoffman's, thank you.
Yeah, Hoffman's and one more.
Sir, Wartenberg.
Start with W. Yeah.
Wartenberg.
Can you spell? Yeah. Someone told correctly.
Sir, Wartenberg sign, sir.
Wartenberg sign. So how will you do that?
Hello.
Can you explain the procedure?
Sir, on interlocking the fingers, the thumb will be adducted, sir.
Okay.
But usually it will be
see the thumb alone or index finger also? Huh?
I'm not sure, sir.
Okay. So today's homework will be you just read what is Wartenberg's sign, what is Hoffman's reflex, and other Babinski's equivalent reflexes in lower limb. Okay. okay? It's a very high yielding topic, and most of the examiners will ask this question in your CNS long case presentation. It is standard questions. All the three questions are standard questions.
Yes.
Okay.
Yes, sir.
Yeah. Next, proceed.
Then deep reflexes are tested, sir. The biceps, triceps, supinator in the upper limb, and knee and ankle jerks in the lower limb. On the left side, they were all present, sir, and knee and ankle jerks were brisk. And on the right side, all the reflexes, deep tendon reflexes.
The question arises is,
yes.
You say that the patient is having human type of lesion.
Yes,
and
sir.
Why all your reflexes are diminished? What is the reason for this?
It possibly
should be exaggerated, right?
Yes, sir. It could be possibly because the patient is still in spine.
Still? I didn't get you.
Patient is in spinal shock, sir.
What is spinal shock? Spinal shock?
Yes. Yeah. So initially the pyramidal tract lesion would be inhibitory to all the spinal neurons, sir. So this diminution of this hypotonia and diminution of reflexes initially, sir, this lasts for hours or days or even weeks, sir.
Okay. So after that spinal shock, what reflex you will expect?
After the spinal shock, when the patient is recovering, we could expect exaggerated reflexes, sir.
So why is the reflexes exaggerated in case of human type?
Because the upper motor neurons are in general inhibitory neurons, sir. And they refine movements.
So what are those neurons called? Gamma neurons.
Gamma neurons, yes, sir.
Yeah, gamma neurons will always be kept under the inhibition of human nerves. Okay. So when the human control is lost now, the gamma neurons take over the place. Okay. So the gamma neurons are overactivated so that a mild touch sensation also causes a drastic deep reflexes. That is why all your deep tendon reflexes are exaggerated.
Yes, sir.
Because the tendon reflexes are under the control of gamma type of neurons. Okay.
Yes.
So all the deep tendon reflexes will be exaggerated only in case of human type of lesion. Whereas in element type of lesion, all the reflexes are lost completely, so that the deep tendon reflexes as well as superficial reflexes will be lost in case of element type of lesion.
Yes, sir.
Able to follow?
Yes, sir.
Okay, proceed.
And gait could not really be tested, sir, because the patient can walk only with support and there were no involuntary movements, sir.
Okay.
And moving on to the sensory system, sir. The superficial senses were tested in all
sensory the system. All were present.
Yes, sir. All of them were present. Superficial, deep, and cortical senses.
Okay, then.
Yes, then. Sir. Autonomic nervous system. There was no for autonomic nervous system testing. We tested for postural hypertension, and there was none, sir. And cerebellar function tests were performed, sir. Finger nose test and finger nose test couldn't be done, sir. And heel shin test, it was present, sir. But tandem walking can't be done, sir. And there was no nystagmus.
Okay.
And there were no spinal and cranial abnormalities, sir.
What are all the spinal and cranial abnormalities you want to look for in this patient?
There could be gibbous, sir.
Is there any relevancy for your case?
No, sir. It's a neuro. It's a sign of.
When you have any cerebellar involvement, the this finding will be relevant.
Yes.
Because you have to look for
cranium base of skull
cranial deformity or CV junctional abnormalities. You read what are the CV junctional abnormalities.
Arnold Chiari malformation.
So in case of cerebellar lesion, yeah, so Arnold Chiari malformation, all those congenital causes, CV junctional abnormalities, all these things are relevant in case of cerebellar lesions. Okay, in a pure CV case like your case, not much importance.
Yes, sir.
Okay, proceed.
Then there were no signs of meningeal irritation, sir, and no carotid bruit was heard on either side.
Okay.
And moving on to the other systems,
the systems are normal.
They're all normal, sir.
Okay. Then.
So the clinical diagnosis so far, it's the patient is a case of right-sided hemiparesis associated with right-sided upper motor neuron type of facial palsy and motor aphasia, probably a thrombotic stroke in the left middle cerebral artery involving the internal capsule of the left hemisphere, with the risk factors of stroke being diabetes mellitus, hypertension, dyslipidemia, and a smoking history.
Dyslipidemia, smoking, as well as diabetic history is there.
And hypertension.
Okay, then.
Then investigations, we could go for total leukocyte differential leukocyte count, ESR for inflammation.
What is the age of the patient?
50.
Yes. So when do you say the patient is stroke in young? What is the cutoff age?
Patient is what, sir? I couldn't hear.
Stroke in young. YOUNG, young. Less than 45 years is considered as stroke in young. Okay.
Yes.
So you have to do them rheumatological workup also. Okay.
Yes. Okay.
Okay. So you want to see lipid profile, creatinine, yes. FBS, PPBS, all those things. Why do you want to do an ECG for this patient? What is the importance of ECG?
ECG, chest X-ray, echocardiogram, all of them. We're looking for cardiac abnormalities, sir. If there's any valvular heart
disease,
valvular heart diseases, sir, which may lead to any thrombus.
Your patient doesn't show any murmur, right?
Yes, sir.
Is there any murmur in cardiovascular system examination?
In this patient, no, sir.
Then why do you want to have valvular heart disease as your differential diagnosis now?
Oh, okay.
It's irrelevant, right?
Yeah, yes, sir.
Instead, you can say that the patient will be having left ventricular hypertrophy and ECG changes for long-standing hypertension.
Yes, sir.
Okay, that should be your answer. Not a valvular heart disease.
Okay, sir.
Okay.
Yes, sir.
Okay, now what is that non-contrast CT scan?
Yes, to rule out any hemorrhagic stroke, possibly any bleeding, intracranial bleeding, sir.
Okay. How much duration of time will it be required for an ischemic stroke to be seen in a CT scan?
Ischemic stroke.
Can you locate a ischemic stroke? when the patient comes very early?
No, sir, we can't. It's only after a period of time, sir.
Period of?
6 to 8 hours, sir.
Yeah, so you cannot pick up a ischemic stroke unless it is a massive stroke.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yes.
Next one, what is the Doppler flow?
To see if there's Doppler any study of, to see if there's any carotid narrowing, sir, and atherosclerosis.
Okay. So will you see only carotid artery or any other artery you will see? It is called as a four vessel Doppler study. So what are all the other two vessels you want to see?
Femoral.
It is called as four vessel Doppler. So you'll be seeing two carotids, and what are all the other two arteries you want to see? Vertebral artery. Okay. Oh, so two vertebral artery and two carotid arteries, that constitutes your four vessel Doppler.
Yes.
Yeah, proceed.
So for treatment, we could put the patient on antiplatelet drugs like tablet aspirin 300 milligrams.
300 milligrams daily. That's a very high dose.
Yes, sir. Okay.
150 milligrams is enough.
Okay, sir.
Speech therapy, limb rehabilitation therapy. So how fast you have to start the limb rehabilitation therapy? Will you start after a day or after a week or after a month? When will you start the rehabilitation therapy?
As soon as we can, sir.
Yeah, as soon as the patient develops stroke, you have to start the limb physiotherapy. Okay, okay. What is the importance of physiotherapy now?
With more lifestyle diseases on the rise, this more cases.
No, only when you start activating the limbs, they will develop collateral circulation.
Yes.
In the brain.
Okay.
Okay. Yes. So in order to develop the collateral circulation, you have to start the limb physiotherapy as early as possible. If you keep delaying, the collateral will not develop and there will be again
atrophy,
circulatory collapse. Okay.
Yes.
Can you do a thrombectomy in this patient? What are all the indications of thrombectomy? What are all the indications of thrombolysis?
Thrombolysis can be done only if the patient is brought in within the golden hours.
Yeah, what is the golden hour?
4.5 hours.
What is the difference? 2.5 hours. What is the drug of choice for thrombolysis?
So, like any tissue plasminogen activators like
altiplase, tenecteplase. What is the dose given?
That I do refer.
Yeah, you have to know all these things. Huh?
Yes.
Tenecteplase dose, altiplase dose. What is streptokinase? Very old drug.
Yes, it's an enzyme derived from streptomyces.
You have to know all these things.
Yes.
Okay. Go back to pharmacology and try to memorize all the drug dosage. Altiplase, tenecteplase and streptokinase. Okay. And you should know the contraindications of thrombolytic therapy also.
So, hemorrhagic stroke, sir.
No, there are many indications of thrombolytic contraindications. Okay, not only hemorrhagic stroke, you have some 5 contraindications, absolute contraindications of thrombolytic therapy. Everything is given in your textbook, standard textbook. Okay.
Yes.
You have to know the dosage, you have to know the contraindications of thrombolytic therapy and as well as indications of thrombolytic therapy.
Yes.
Okay. Now, what are the long-term complications of your case? What are the long-term complications? What happens when you don't do physiotherapy?
So then the
patient will go for disuse atrophy.
Yes, sir.
Disuse atrophy. Yes, what is a deadly complication of a CVA case with 9th and 10th cranial nerve involvement?
Aspiration.
Patient can go for aspiration pneumonitis. Yes. Okay. What about the long standing pressure sores? We can have
bed sores.
Bed sores. So, what are the 3 B's you want to take care of CVA patients? 3 B.
B.
Bowel care, bladder care, and back care. Okay. So, the bowel should be taken care, the bladder should be taken care, and back. Back is for the bed sores.
Bed sores.
Okay. So, the patient should be put on alpha bed, where the pressure source will not get. Alpha bed. Okay.
Yes.
Just Google search what is alpha bed. Okay. ALPHA, alpha bed. Limb physiotherapy should be given. A Ryle's tube should be inserted. That is, nasogastric tube should be inserted. Okay. For Ryle's tube feeding purpose. In order to prevent the aspiration pneumonitis. Chest physiotherapy should be given. Limb physiotherapy should be given. Okay.
Yes.
All these are long-term complication and treatment to be followed. Is there anything called a scar epilepsy, you know?
Yes, sir. Scar.
So your brain goes in for scar. Wherever there are blocks, gliosis will happen and it leads on to scar epilepsy.
Even in trauma.
Quite rare, but you should also know regarding this. Scar epilepsy. Okay. And the main thing here is you have to control smoking and stop smoking within a period of time. Second thing is control your hypertension and diabetes with antihypertensive and insulin or OHS, oral hypoglycemic drugs. Okay, that is more important. And speech therapy. Speech therapy, many people will not regain the speech once it is affected. Since it is motor aphasia, the patient will able to understand whatever you speak. Okay, only the word output will not be there. All right.
So, but in general, stroke, thrombotic stroke tends to have a good prognosis, sir. Compared to
hemorrhagic stroke, your thrombotic stroke will have a better prognosis. Hemorrhagic stroke will go for worsening symptoms will be more.
Yes.
When you compare with thrombotic phenomenon.
Thrombotic.
Why don't you say that your patient is not having embolic type of stroke? What is the defensive mechanism now you want to tell? That it is not an embolic stroke.
In embolic stroke, they have maximum deficit at the onset and then it gets better, sir.
Is it progressive or non-progressive?
It's non-progressive, sir.
Non-progressive, well.
With maximum
deficit. No, any valvular disease or there is no murmur, yes, you can hear in the cardiovascular system.
Yes.
So that itself say that the patient is not having any cardiac issue. And there is no carotid bruit also.
Yes.
Okay. Then what else you want to give in the treatment part? The patient is having dyslipidemia, you have to start on atorvastatin or phenofibrates if the triglyceride levels are high.
Oh, yes.
Okay. When do you want to catheterize this patient? Urinary catheterization.
When the patient has a retention of urine, sir, that's...
How common is retention of urine in case of UMN type of lesion? In the LMN type, you can see the retention of urine because the bladder control is fully lost. But in case of yeoman type, how common is the
urogenic
bladder or whatever it is? Not much common.
Yes.
Okay. The only indication for catheterization is patient is unable to walk, patient becomes bedridden.
Yes.
Almost in the first 48 hours of stroke, the patient will be in a semi-conscious or unconscious state. So, in order to prevent that complication, we catheterize this patient. Okay. Otherwise, there is no much indication for catheterization in case of UMN type of lesions. Able to follow?
Yes, sir. Sir, it is speech therapy, limb therapy, and one more therapy you said, sir. Rehabilitation.
Any other doubts you have?
The therapy, sir, like other than speech and limb, what was the other one?
Are you there, ma'am? Presenter?
Yes, sir. Can you hear me, sir? Huh?
Can you hear?
Yes, sir. We can hear. We can hear you, sir.
Any other doubt, ma?
Sir, can you hear me, sir?
Yeah, yeah. Now only I can hear you.
Yes,
any other doubts you have?
I was asking, other than speech therapy and limb therapy, what was the other therapy you mentioned, sir? There was one more.
Physiotherapy. Limb physiotherapy.
Other than that, sir, speech and limb physiotherapy, other than that.
So these two are the main things.
Okay, sir.
Next thing is that bed sore, alpha bed. All these three things are the rehabilitation therapy. You have any other doubts, ma?
Nothing else from anyone. I think so, sir.
It's clear now.
Yes, sir. It's clear.
Okay, fine. So, if there is no other doubt, we can wind up. You please send me the attendance details alone. Okay?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
How many were absent today? You just send me that alone.
I will send, sir.
Yeah, okay. Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you so much, sir.